And welcome to round 8 of Pro Tour Theros. We've got a great feature match for you here. On the left of your screen, that is Paul Rietzl. He is playing the black-white deck from Star City Games. And on the right of our screen, there's David Caplan, mono-red. This is exactly the deck that David Caplan likes playing in Standard.
Yeah, team face-to-face games, works with Alexander Dehane quite often. There's a turn two Precinct Captain.
Now, the first strike on Precinct Captain, really, really relevant in this format. If it stays alive.
Yeah. And there's
Burning Tree MSC into Gorehouse Chainwalker.
Is the Gorehouse Chainwalker chained or unchained?
It looks like it's entirely chained.
Ha! Huh.
The leash is still there.
Let's take a look at each of these players' hands here. Let's start with Paul Rietzl, the Pro Tour Amsterdam champion.
So this is a black-white deck that you described it as white permanents, black spells.
Yeah. But some black permanents too. No, it's like a weird, white weenie control deck.
And we know that Paul Rietzl loves white weenie. We've seen him win a Pro Tour with it. But here there's Desecration Demons, Doomblades, Thoughtseizers. He's got a lot of different things going on.
So there you see David Caplan decided he was going to double block the Precinct Captain in the hopes of killing it. But a Doomblade took out one of the blockers, and then First Strike took out the other one. Precinct Captain lives to fight another day.
And Chandra's Phoenix just smashing in the air, though. This one helped out by so much quality burn in the format. But in a straight-up race, the Phoenix probably not going to do it against the Captain, right?
No, I don't think so.
And Rietzl here.
He's holding another one. I mean, he wants to just get his damage in before the Desecration Demon comes online.
That demon really tough for Caplan to deal with because, I mean, he can sacrifice some creatures, but his creatures can't really pile on the pressure in quite the same way.
How? What just happened? We already have one game result in the feature match area. Sounds like Mete Zadelkai has a one game lead over Paulo Vitor Damodaroso already.
I mean, even mulligans take a long time, right? They don't just happen in.
Tidebinder Mage
did the job. The first one may not have. The second and third ones between them were able to do a number on Paulo Vitor Damodaroso. So Mete Zadelkai, a very, very quick lead there in the feature match area.
There we see Thoughtseize from Paul Rietzl. Took a shock that David Caplan had an opportunity to play last turn on the Precinct Captain.
Here's the punishment.
Yeah, and now he will get punished for that. Here comes a token.
So 4 damage there with Mutavolt coming in. Soldier token coming off the Precinct Captain. Paul Rietzl, assuming he gets to 4 land, gets to cast that Desecration Demon, there's really not much more that he could ask for from his start.
There's a second Chandra's Phoenix. Gets Paul down to 14 or 12?
Down to 12.
12, there we go.
I mean, you'd have thought that the mono-red deck, that this would be the fastest deck in the feature match area. This a feature match area with 42 Pro Tour top 8s in total.
Wow.
That little stat there from Pro Tour statistician Mr. Richard Hagen. I mean, that's absurd. I mean, I know that we get to pick the matches, but, like, there's 2 players in each match, and all of these players are just of the absolute top caliber.
Here comes another Precinct Captain after Mutavault, Token, and Precinct Captain come in.
So Caplan down to 11 now, and his hand is just land, so basically, everything he's got is out there on the board right now.
Well, there's a chained Cackler.
Caplan all about the chained monsters at the moment, and quite frankly, that's not where they're happiest, and it's probably not where he's happiest either. All it's going to be is a blocker. Like, the best it can do is, what, trade with a soldier?
Keep in mind, I mean, he has Paul down to 8.
I mean, I guess, yeah. Two attacks in the air will do it, but
2 attacks were running burn spells.
Yes. Mutavolt here jumping in the way of something.
He's gonna block 2 tokens.
I mean, yeah, blocking 1 captain because a token's coming back somewhere or another, right?
Yeah, goes the land destruction route here. Wastelands.
Yeah, and why not? Pretty powerful in Legacy. And we know that Caplan loves a bit of Legacy. That the area that he sort of first made a name for himself. Not played on the Pro Tour, but as it turns out, He's been pretty successful on the pro scene also with his standard decks more often.
Ultimately decides to eat a token.
Well, first trick damage. Might as well do it in order. So that guy's dead. I'm going to go damage. You take another 3. Go to 6. Might as well do that here.
All right. So Caplan now on 6. This game will not take much longer. And that looked like a lightning strike there, drawn by Caplan. And that very relevant given Paul's life total.
2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Doing some math, trying to figure out if he can weather this attack and fling the burn at Paul's head.
It's going to be a close one. And that one of the things that, like...
Nope, decides the lightning strike. Says I've got to just kill you with my flyers in the air anyway, right?
I mean, lots of people talk about the red decks as if they're really straightforward to play. Like, working out where that burn's going, really important. And we've seen from the likes of Patrick Sullivan that, like, when you play the red deck right, super, super powerful, and playing it right is not a straightforward task. That Godless Shrine mocking Paul Rietzl a little bit probably doesn't really want to have to play it untapped. But, I mean... I guess if he's on 4 anyway, like, he's already facing lethal.
Activate.
Yeah.
Kill it.
And Hero's downfall for the Mutavolt there. That's enough to secure the game for Paul Rietzl. He takes the first one in a really close race.
Wow. Yeah, it said 6 on the screen, but I guess that was...
Black Source.
Oh, no, that was 6, because the Mutavolt gets through.
Yeah. The Mutavolt animates, but before it gets a chance to block, just kills it off.
Paul Rietzl's great at exactly 20 damage.
You can play Magic at a store near you every Friday. Earn Planeswalker points and battle against your friends in Friday Night Magic. October's FNM promo is Gore Clan Rampager. Visit wizards.com/FNM to find a store near you. So we've had some pretty quick matches in the feature match area already. Mutavolt, key in both of these decks. Not everyone can play it because of Devotion, but...
I mean, the question coming into this tournament for a lot of teams was Nykthos Shrine to Nyx or Mutavolt, right? They had sort of spot for one or the other.
Yeah, I mean, as we see here, it's a land that can attack, interacts with tribal cards... Zathrid Necromancer mentioned here.
We saw Gelrider Sliver Master of Waves both interact with this card beautifully.
Absolutely, yeah. Definitely not worth forgetting the fact that this is all creature types, because some of those creature types super relevant.
Creature types, Morning Tide, a set that cared about creature types quite a bit.
And in Modern Masters, some of the stuff that it did in there, I mean, it's a giant.
Well, it was originally going to be in Modern Masters, but they decided to put it into M14 to give aggro decks a reason to be two colors.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. I mean, it's interesting that sort of you'd have thought the monocolored decks could go, well, you know, we can just play Mutavolt, it doesn't really hurt us. But because of Devotion, it's a real decision.
Yeah.
And Caplan here, one of the red decks that's saying, you know what? I don't want Devotion. I want to be faster than that. I want to not let you get time to get Devotion going. I'm just going to kill you. And Rietzl's deck is pretty quick, but on paper, not perhaps quite as quick as Caplan's, though one way or another, we're going to have a quick match here, I think.
Right. Both these players are sitting at 7-0.
Yeah, I mean, the perfect day one doesn't assure you a top 8, but like you can't ask for anything more, right?
it's as good as it gets. I mean, you can have a fairly mediocre day 2 and have some great tiebreakers and feel pretty good. You come out of
And it sounds like we've got another result here. Rob Doherty from the USA, another Hall of Famer.
Who just did a deck tech with Zach Hill, talking about his Selesnya deck.
1-0 against Willie Adel. Nice position to be in. He's on 15 points at the moment, so a little bit more work to do, but you got to keep winning, right?
Yeah. This is it's a long road. It's a long 2 days to get to that top 8.
Absolutely, yeah.
And it's like as soon as you you see players a lot of times as soon as they sort of let up, it's that keeping that even keel, right? Not getting too high on being 8-0. and not getting too low on being 5'3".
Yeah, so I remember speaking to Craig Jones. Now, Craig Jones, obviously best remembered for the top deck Lightning Helix, which took him into the finals of the first Pro Tour Honolulu. But he's someone who has had it both ways. He's had the undefeated day one, and then, I mean, Pro Tour LA, he went undefeated day one, and then basically OX'd day two. Like, keeping on a straight even keel and just saying, I'm going to take each match as it comes, win them all. And then just make top eight. Like, it's not an easy task, and the psychological side of it really important.
Yeah,
it's like the Irish guys are telling me, oh, isn't Guinness big in Scottsdale?
Looks like this sleeve is scratched. Can I switch it?
Please.
Just fixing a sleeve there for Caplan. Got to make sure that everything is all above board and neat before you go into the match.
And I believe Paul Rietzl was talking about some local tourism.
I mean, if you're going to be traveling to the other side of the world to play an event, you don't just want to, you know, come and play cards. You've got to at least see a little bit of where you're coming to, right?
You're in England. Have you been to Ireland before?
My first time in Ireland, actually. Bizarrely, I've been to Japan like 3 or 4 times. But, like, I mean, admittedly, the Pro Tour helped me get there too.
Sure.
But, yeah, this is my first time in Ireland, and I've got a day or so after the Pro Tour finishes to go and do my proper sightseeing.
Oh, excellent, excellent. Definitely do the Colmain in jail.
Yeah, I saw your photos on Facebook, and it just seemed
pretty spectacular, pretty moving, amazing insight into the history of Ireland as a, you know, free country.
Absolutely, yeah. And it's awesome to me that because of the Pro Tour, I get to go to, like, 3 or 4, like, awesome, like, little mini break holidays away and see all sorts of different things every single year. And it looks like our players are just looking at their opening hands. That looks like a pretty solid one. 2 lands and a bunch of 1 and 2 cost spells for the red deck. Not necessarily an unusual starting hand, but certainly a powerful one.
Found your Street Denizen for David Caplan.
That one, pretty rare that that 1-1 is just a 1-1. There we see it getting in for 2 immediately as it's joined by a 5-fist striker.
Does he have a Chandra's Phoenix to assemble the battalion?
Oh. It looks like Soldier of the Pantheon there, not at its best. I mean, it'll trade with one of these creatures, but other creature.
I'm invulnerable. Nothing can... Oh, wait. Ow. Yeah, ow, that burns. Like, that burns. What's going on? Thought I was invulnerable.
And, not only is he vulnerable, he can't even block. So Caplan here with a pretty decent start. Maybe not the perfect start, but he's certainly not going to be complaining.
A very, very rare agreement between 2 Magic players. Matej Zadelkaj wins to go to 7-1, defeating Paulo Vitor Domodossola 2-0, and both players agree it wasn't close.
A great little bit of editorial there coming from our sideline reporter, Richard Miller. 2-0, and, like, we still haven't had a game result from John Finkel versus Patrick Chapin. They're still playing game 1, I believe.
Exile or discard?
It exiles it.
Oh, we've just heard that Finkel is actually 1-0 up there. So
Sin Collector takes a lightning strike
from Caplan?
From Caplan, yeah. Lightning strikes 2-1. Battalions.
Lightning does strike twice.
Yeah. I go to 9. And gets Paul down to 9.
This is not looking close, to take the vernacular from the Matej Zadelkaj match at present. I mean, as long as that 5-fist strike is around.
And there's another one waiting in the wings.
And there's basically not been a turn yet where Rietzl has been able to do a reasonable block. And basically that's all he wants to do right now. A little shake of the head there from Paul Rietzl, and I'm guessing that's not him dancing along to whatever music's playing in his head right now.
Maybe he's got a Fiend Slayer Paladin that he is.
Well, that one a pretty solid one, though it doesn't actually have protection from red, so still potentially going to be
Can't be the target of spells.
Yeah.
Red or black spells.
I mean, I guess the first strike means it's pretty reasonable in any of these fights, but that's only if it can actually block. Because the likes of Goblin Shortcutter, for example, could just come down and say, "Nah, you can't block this turn, and you're very, very nearly dead."
This is what Paul Rietzl has to work with here.
So the Whip of Erebos, the lifelink, going to be very relevant if he can stay alive and keep creatures on the board for long enough. Precinct Captain, obviously a fantastic blocker as well. But again, all of these caveated by if you can stay alive long enough. And there's the first unleashed creature of the match, Rakdos Cackler, also another Fire Fist Striker. So this next turn's attack is going to be brutal.
I'm not going to block this guy. I'm thinking about those guys. You have one card, right?
Yeah.
And Rietzl, the one with the pedigree for playing aggro decks since forever. So
Caplan at Worlds, when he made the top 8, was also playing a mono red deck. He is quite comfortable setting things on fire and turning things sideways.
But each of these players very comfortable in the red zone and figuring out the complicated damage races. So this kind of a masterclass, I guess, in the aggro mirror.
Trying to figure out how to block with his Sin Collector.
I mean, Sin Collector already done some good work there. Getting rid of a Lightning Strike, clearly huge, and finally gets involved in blocking. Kills off one of the Fire Fist Strikers, because let's face it, if there's two of them on the board, then basically there's nothing doing for Paul Rietzl next turn in terms of getting in the way.
Takes 5, goes down to 4 here.
This looks like the comeback that David Caplan needed.
I mean, you know that someone plays a lot of red when they have their special red lands.
Yeah, those mountains look like they're original beta mountains.
Yes.
So these mountains, older than various players on this Pro Tour.
Sure. Older than Shahar Shenhar.
Absolutely. Older than our current world champion. But you know what? They still tap for red mana like any other.
And then we see the one card looming in David Caplan's hand is a Lightning Strike.
So Paul Rietzl on a virtual one life here.
Well, I mean, he also, you know, if regardless of, you know, if he plays a small blocker, he's able to kill that and then, you know, sort of stun the Fiend Slayer Paladin with a Fire Fist Strike.
Yeah, like definitely a hard place for Rietzl here.
Instead, Paul says, I'm going to get in and gain 2 life. I'm going to go to 6 here.
And I guess if he knows that he's not got a reasonable blocker to play.
Go.
He does have a Muta Vault.
Everybody's coming in.
This is going to be a Devour Flesh. Says 1/1's gonna go away.
Yeah, so he's got just enough to stay alive here, except for that Lightning Strike.
Right, he's like, let me wait until you're all tapped and committed to this process, and then I'll show you what I got. Show me what you got. I will show you what I got.
So 1/1 between these two aggro decks. We will have a rubber game here. Show your devotion to Theros today by purchasing your magic apparel at mtgmerch.com. Now, a whole bunch of different magic shirts there, all of them Theros themed. I'm currently going for the Planeswalker Nyx themed ones, the one on the far left there, but all of these pretty cool.
Yeah, I really like the Planeswalker symbol one. Quite a bit.
I actually like both the Planeswalkers. So the one on the far right as well, like the Planeswalker symbol's just sort of a very iconic new symbol to Magic that
looks nice under a blazer. That's what I care about.
Convenient for today. And indeed the whole weekend.
So, sounds like John Finkel, Patrick Chapin is tied up at one game apiece. And that is that the only other match in the feature match area right now? Take a look at Lightning Strike. That was the card that just came, finished the game out for David Caplan. Efficient 2-mana spell, can kill most heroes.
I mean, it can also be used to, like, deal with Bestow creating the massive
creatures.
I mean, I'd rather not have the one massive creature. Like,
right.
Obviously, that's only if you can get there in response to the spell, before the Bestow, I guess.
So, it's a functional reprint of Searing Spear, and if you're wondering why isn't this just Searing Spear then, it's meant to show off the god Kuranos. So it has some flavor implications which is why they went this way with the card.
Now, we've not seen Kuranos yet.
I was just thinking the same thing. Maybe it's in David Kaplan's sideboard.
But yeah, like a few, like checking the flavor text in some of the cards from Theros, there's definitely a few teasers of things to come.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, it's not done.
Yeah, there is more to go.
Reminded of the Mel Brooks routine from, History of the World. It's like, these Therons, they have a god for everything.
Comfortable shoes.
Here we see these guys shuffling up. Before I venture down too far down that road.
But yeah, like lots of things to still come. We're going to Nyx at some point.
Yeah.
Have a little journey there. See what's going on. Seeing what's born of the gods, They've been up to stuff. Stuff's getting born.
Nyx is going to be an interesting place. I mean, just the shrine has been all the rage this weekend.
I mean, we've already seen a lot of good things to show devotion to. There has to be more, right?
Cycle of gods that have four colored mana in the...
Oh, wow.
Cast of gods.
Don't you worry about devotion, guys. I'm just devoted to myself.
God of narcissism.
Costs 5 black.
Yeah. B.
What's
your... B.
Well, in Modern, it's Splinter Twin. I play a lot of Vintage. Or I used to play a lot of Vintage.
Get the cards?
Yeah. Nice. People have started tweeting me their favorite lines from History of the World.
Fantastic. I expect a full rendition this evening as we draft.
Let's face it, you can't talk them out of anything. Here we go. Game 3.
And?
Paul Rietzl on... The play.
The play, a very important factor in an aggro mirror like this. Well, an aggro matchup. Clearly, this is far from being a mirror, but for Mutavolt. And looks like lands and spells again there for David. That one of the things I guess to be said for playing a mono-colored deck. It's not just about devotion. You always hit the right color of mana.
Although we have seen like the double Mutavolt can't cast... A Chandra Scenic draw, but that's pretty rare.
A little bit of scrying going on here from Paul Rietzl. He's not going to have a turn two drop Precinct Captain, but there's almost certainly going to be at least one 2-drop here from David Caplan.
1, 2, okay.
And of course, the Fireface Strike getting so much better when it's joined by a friend immediately. So much easier to make a battalion, and Caplan very close to having one already.
I believe we're not quite there yet on the push tool, but I believe he is holding a Chandra's Phoenix.
There it is, the team. A hero's downfall immediately dealing with the striker there. We see Rietzl showing a huge amount of respect for the striker.
It really was the difference in that last game. I mean, he just didn't have any time to hide behind anything.
Like, I don't know if there was more than about one block in the entirety of that second game. And we see in this match, potentially, Rietzl deciding to go big for the third game.
Look at this hand that Paul Rietzl has.
Oof. So Hero's downfall to set up, and then Blood Baron of Viscopa to knock it down. I mean, the lifelink there, just huge. Opposite that, of course, no slouch either, it must be said.
Mm-hmm. 10 to 20.
I mean, Caplan doing good work. He's got Rietzl down to 10.
Short cutter says, Sin Collector can't block, and then get you down to 10.
And another Chandra's Phoenix in David Caplan's hand. This is going to be a really...
Wow. Blood Baron or Viscopa could change this match considerably. Blood Baron of Viscopa and Obsidian Ghost Council Booth going to make things very, very rough. You're going to have to put in some overtime here, David Caplan. It's not going to just be... We're not just doing 20 damage here in this office. We're going to need you to do a little more. Yeah. We're going to need you to chip in. We're going to need you to
show
stay late
a bit of commitment.
Tonight. Yeah, yeah. Show us what you got. You got to make an impression on us.
So there's the Blood Baron. Lots of abilities on this card. Almost all of them fairly relevant in this match, it must be said. The lifelink, pretty big. Both Chandra's Phoenix is coming in.
And Caplan is on Mountain.
The first chunk coming out there. 16 plays 10 now?
Yep.
Oof. There's Obsidat. Another little bit of drain there, 2-point drain, and is Rietzl going to keep Obsidat around as a hefty blocker here? Looks like he might.
Yes, he does. Paul has climbed all the way to 12. Rakdos Cackler is way out of his weight class.
Yeah, like, this is no longer the bantam weights. These are some pretty heavyweight monsters.
I'll tell you when they're final blocks, okay?
Obsidat, happy to get blocking here.
Two cards.
Yep. What do you have? Do you have a Rakdos Cackler?
I'm trying to play around these 1-1 unleash monsters, but you're just not giving me the opportunity to.
Paul Rietzl goes back down to 6, but he's going to be able to climb back to 10. And we know he's holding a pair of Heroes Downfalls, so he can deal with both those flyers next turn. Or this turn. Or is he only holding one Heroes Downfall? He is only holding one.
Looks like it's just the one.
Yeah, it's just
the
one, yeah.
I mean, one probably enough to keep this race, I want to say fair, but it's clearly not fair at all, is it? I mean, both of the creatures on Rietzl's side of the board just massively outclassing everything that Caplan's got. All Caplan has going for him is raw aggression, and that raw aggression hitting a brick wall
here. And forcing Paul to think about, like, how far back do I need to stay here?
Like, does he basically have to assume that every card in Caplan's hand is 3 damage, that is a burn spell?
Or, you know, if he's holding a Goblin Shortcutter, or, yeah, Burn Spell, he hasn't seen the decklist. He doesn't know that there's not an act of treason.
A Fanatic of Mogus, maybe.
A Fanatic of Mogus, absolutely. That would be pretty ridiculous here. Do we have a Fanatic of Mogus?
We have 2 Acts of Treason in the sideboard, so they potentially could be very relevant here. But I don't know whether or not Caplan would have had the read to bring these in.
Yeah. Is that your attack?
Yes.
Block. Hold on.
And Rietzl now looking like he's going to pull the trigger. I'm not sure where I'd call Chandra's Felix a hero, but it's fallen out the sky.
Yeah. That is dead.
And a Doomblade there, Paul Rietzl drawing for his turn. More removal is pretty good for him right now. He just needs to keep chunking on through.
It's been fascinating, though, how Caplan's just, you know, I mean, not that he has a different line to take, but his aggression has forced that Obsidot Ghost Council to just, you know, not do its thing, right? It's just like,
yeah, I mean,
it's just big, right? It's like a green creature all of a sudden.
It's Polychronos with no monstrosity.
Yeah.
I mean, which is still pretty exciting.
Yeah.
let's be real here. But yeah, I mean, the demeanor of David Caplan the entire time he's played it the whole way through, Rietzl has been forced to really think about everything that's going on.
But Caplan's sitting at one now. And now it's time.
Yeah.
So, killing.
And there's the handshake. Paul Rietzl, 2-1.
Wow. That was very impressive.
Very aggressive. This boy here have alligator blood.
Obsidat blood.
Oh, wow.
You had a burn spell?
No, but like I needed to play as if I did.
Right.
Looking to ignite your competitive spark? Take your game to a Grand Prix and see how you fare against the best players in your region, as well as top visiting Magic pros. Upcoming Grand Prix include Louisville, Hong Kong, Antwerp, Santiago, and Valencia. For more information, visit wizards.com/Grand Prix.
I guess we'll probably be at the same table tomorrow, right?
So,
the players are drafting together tomorrow. 8-0-7-1. It looks like we're going to go over to a pretty marquee match here.
Star City Games shirts on both sides.
Two different decks,
though.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've seen the black-white deck already in Paul Rietzl's hands. I believe it's a pretty similar build. Those players on the same team, of course. But there's the handshake.
And John Finkel wins the match.
So John Finkel went into that match on 18 points. He's on 21. Just
7-1. What a great day one for him.
I mean, I'm not surprised he's done well. This deck seems to me like the John Finkel deck. I mean, think about it, if you get Thassa down with the Biden, then basically you can turn any creature into a Shadow Mage Infiltrator. You've got, you know, Nykthos, Shrine to Nyxo, like you've got all of these effectively rituals. You can just storm up, you can cast so many spells in a turn. Like, this is just the summation of what John Finkel does.
Those two Hall of Famers are done. Let's go to Hall of Famer Rob Doherty and someone who's been in the Hall of Fame discussion this year and will probably remain in the Hall of Fame discussion going into next year, Brazil's Willie Adel. Rob Doherty is on your left. He's playing green-white. And
that's a lot of loyalty there. 6 loyalty there on our Johnny Call of the Pride, at which point he becomes a very, very dangerous threat indeed. And a ratchet bomb there from Doherty. It's going to take.
That was Adel who played the.
Oh, from Adel.
Well, Adel, currently the 6th ranked player in the Magic Pro Tour top 25.
So, yeah, I mean, we often talk about Paulo Vitor Dama de Rosa as being sort of the big Brazilian player to watch out for. But actually, it was Willie that was leading the team there at Worlds this year.
There you get a look at Rob Doherty's stats. He's one of the older players on the Pro Tour. Coming up on his 300th pro point with his appearance here today. 5 top 8s, he's got a win. Looks like maybe the Mutavault are keeping that... the threat of Mutavault are keeping the Experiment 1 at bay.
Though, of course, Ratchet Bomb now ticked up high enough that it can force the Experiment 1 to lose a few counters to regenerate.
Right. But what we know is that Rob Doherty is holding Advent of the Worm.
Now, as I understand it, a monster of that size with double strike is a pretty clear and present danger to Willie Hadel's life total.
So he sacks the Ratchet Bomb, regenerates the experiment one. It taps, though, as part of being regenerated. Income to Mutavault from Willy Adel.
I smell an ambush here.
And here comes a 5-5 monster.
This the format of monstrous monsters, but this one's been around for a while.
Takes a worm token out of his graveyard. Blocks a Mutavault. Willy Adel defiantly throws the other Mutavault into the graveyard.
Willy Adel currently ranked 6, and the performance he's putting in here, he's got every reason to think that he's going to at least maintain his rank, if not potentially improve on it a little bit.
So another Mutavault comes down for Willy Adel.
Both these players currently on 15 points. They've had 2 losses, but hoping to finish up the day with a win, go into drafting tomorrow in really good shape. So we see another experiment one there in Rob Doherty's hand. Not necessarily likely to evolve anytime soon, but he may just not mind, because ultimately Willy Adel's on 4 life and Rob Doherty has 2 fairly beefy threats.
Okay, there was a little confusion as we shifted over very quickly. Rob Doherty's on 4, so he needs to be very mindful of his attacks here. You know, does not want to let 2 Mutavaults just sneak in and steal this match away from him. It's just that he feels like he's beginning to wrest control of it.
Yeah, time to protect his lead at the moment. He's leading 1-1 up in the match. Advent of the Worm token is coming in. It's not going to take that many turns for it to make these life totals far more similar. And Experiment 1, a perfectly fine blocker when that's what Rob Doherty needs.
Right, there you get a look at a Johnny Caller of the Pride, yeah. Which he's going to be able to, you know, make 4 cat tokens next turn.
Not the most exciting number of cat tokens, but it'll be enough. And the double strike, I mean, all 3 abilities on this Planeswalker are very effective, but one of the things that's most impressive about this one, just it comes down on turn 3 and it's got 4 loyalty before you do anything.
Yeah, here's a Lifebane zombie. It just sees a land from Rob Doherty.
Normally, of course, a fantastic sideboard card in this matchup, able to take just about anything from Rob's hand, but that's only if he's got a threat, and right now all his threats sat on the board.
Here we go. Willy Adel's at 8. How do you feel about a flying double strike? Advent of the Worm. Is that something you would be interested in, Robert Doherty?
Just having a little think about it. There's 8 counters there. All 3 abilities live.
Flying and double strike.
That is a sizable worm. Ending this game. There's the handshake. Rob Doherty advancing to 6-2. Willy Adel now.
Still alive at 5-3. Sounds like we're gonna get a chance to talk to Rob Doherty, but
don't have enough for it.
You know, we'll let those guys get set up down there. We did a deck tech actually with Rob Doherty.
Oh, awesome.
You know, and his green white Selesny deck. You know, one of the sort of known the pillars of the format into the standard. You know, one of the early decks that we saw week 1, and you know, people had like a couple options. They're like, well, you know, I can pick up this deck that I know does well and I know fares well, and then I can make some adjustments to it.
Yeah.
Or I can unveil my secret tech.
And there's been a fair amount of unveiling today. I mean, we've finished our day's rounds of standard today. Obviously, we've got a whole bunch more tomorrow before we get to top 8, but we've seen a lot of new decks.
Right. I do feel like that somewhere around round 2 there was a lot of people, you know, pulling the cloche up off of their deck, and everyone's like, oh, Nykthos, Shrine to Nyx. Oh, yeah, that's what I built too. All right. Let's see what Rob Doherty has to say about his Selesny deck and his, you know, 6-2 day 1 performance here for the Pro Tour Hall of Famer.
Hey, Rashad Miller, and I'm here with Hall of Famer Rob Doherty. Now, with all of these crazy devotion decks and these super grindy control decks, lying around this tournament. Yep. What made you decide to take a very traditional kind of on-curve green-right approach to this tournament?
Well, I think it's very important for players to know themselves. And I like playing control, and I'm pretty good at it. But the last time I played control on a Pro Tour, I had three draws, and draws are two-thirds of a loss. So I decided I wanted to go with some beat down. And this deck can basically fight anybody. It's close to a buy versus the red decks. It can fight versus any creature decks, and it's got decent game versus the control with your voices and all your flash creatures. So it's got a lot of game, and you're beating down, so you don't have to worry so much about the clock.
All right. Well, you have a very impressive day one record. How do you feel you're going to do day two in the draft? How comfortable are you in draft? And how do you think your deck is going to fare in the day two metagame?
Sure. Well, I work a lot, and I have four kids. I've got a Kickstarter going for a new game, Star Realms, and we've got and I'm working with Stoneblade Entertainment. So I've got a lot of work, a lot of kids. So I practiced a little bit. I did some constructed testing, and then. My very first play experience with the new set, my pre-release was the Star City Games Team Sealed, which we managed to top four, so that was cool. And then I did a bunch of drafting on Magic Online. So I've gotten past that steep part of the curve, so I did the quick learning that you can, where you can pick up most of it. But I wouldn't call myself a master of the format. And obviously, going into day two with a good record, you're starting to go against the people who actually test all the time. So yeah, I'm kind of in the gamer dad category, like a lot of the Magic players out there, where I love Magic and I play it when I can, but you know, there's a lot of real life that interferes. So I'll do my best. We'll battle.
Well, obviously, the best of luck to you tomorrow. And this is Rashad Miller, and we're going to send it back to the booth.
Thanks.
Rob Doherty, flying the flag for gamer dads everywhere.
Yeah. But, you know, I know a lot of gamer dads, certainly in the New York, New Jersey area, who are going to be excited to hear that and excited to see, you know, someone waving that flag all the way into day two in pretty solid position, probably at a, you know, terrific draft table. He
Absolutely.
Did well in his first draft. If he can do that again, he's going to be in great shape to maybe make a run, you know, for a top eight for gamer dads everywhere.
Yeah, and, you know, gamer workers, gamer businessmen, you know, Paul Rietzl has a full-time job and still makes it to wins Pro Tour. So everybody can win a Pro Tour. You just need to be really good at Magic.
Let's find out about some of those everybodies back at the news desk and see who else has been doing well here at Pro Tour Theros. For Tim Willoughby, this is Brian David Marshall sending it back to the desk.
And welcome back to the news desk, guys. Some intense action happening out there. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. I am with Zach Hill. And we've got some more updates coming in. Now, there's still 10-ish minutes left in the round, so they're going to be coming fast and furious here as we see updates. I've been checking my computer screen here, but why don't we put up the results screen so that we can get you guys a snapshot of some of the highlights here. The first thing that you'll see, not quite updated yet there, but Paul Rietzl, he beat Dave Caplan. We saw that in the feature match area to improve to a mighty impressive and perfect record of 8-0. Another player who's also at 8-0, freshly off of a win over Pierre Degas, is Sam Black. And we're going to have an interesting discussion about that in a few minutes, Zach. There's a same team, different deck, same record. And it is the ideal record. So that's pretty awesome. Still waiting on Finkel versus Chapin, Calcano versus Alexei Shassov. So we'll see on that one. Ole Rade, he's a Hall of Famer.
Yes.
He is 6-2. After losing to Lukas Yaklovsky, who improves to 7-1. So Lukas Yaklovsky, the guy's kind of a machine.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he puts up solid records time and time and time again.
Yeah, I mean, and really, you know, the Czech Republic is their entire, like, country.
Yeah.
Just is a playtesting team.
Uh-huh.
Like, I was talking to Tony Portland in
like
Croatia,
the
and they said
like
they
every
just
citizen
were all playing
play
together.
Test?
Yeah.
Like,
the entire country. It's actually nationally
that's
mandated.
That's awesome. I want to go there.
It's like national service.
Yeah. No, I've been there, and I didn't see that many Magic cards.
You should have looked harder. But, yeah, I mean, they've got Mate Zadonkai. Yes. They've got, or, you know, from the region. They've got, obviously, Stanislav Sivka. Mm-hmm. And they've got Jaklovski, as well as a host of other supporting players. Yeah. So, I mean, they are a powerhouse.
Yeah, it's really impressive. Taking a look at another record here, Jacob Van Loonen, we work with him, and he was 5-1 coming in the round. He picked up a loss here, but he's still 6-2, so very solid start. He 3-0'd the draft, and he 3-2'd the standard portion. He was very happy with his deck coming in. He was testing with Brian Brandwein and Jerry Thompson, doing some testing there. But Michael Derzo beat him 2-0. So those are some of the early results that we have. And it looks like Alexei Shasov has defeated Christian Calcano here. So he beat him 2-0. So let's see where that puts them. Christian Calcano, 6-2. So banging start. You mentioned that he was pretty confident with his...
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say. I mean, these two losses, really huge for Calcano. I mean, I know how easy it is to come off. I mean, when I was pro touring, I just can't tell you how many 4-0, 5-0, 6-0 starts that I had. But the problem is keeping up your focus and keeping up your momentum. Because once you lose one, you start to tell yourself a story. Mm-hmm. You know, you're like, okay, you know, you slack off a little bit. It's the end of the day. You get tired. And two quick losses, all of a sudden you're back in the middle of the pack again.
That's right.
I mean, you know, 6-2, you're still very well positioned to set up a solid day two.
Yeah.
But it's not a free roll.
It's not. Like it and it's not one of those, you know, because if you can manage to go in undefeated, you have so much flexibility, right? Like things can go a little wrong for you and you can still have a legitimate shot to make a run at the top eight with two losses. The news tightens a little.
Yeah, I mean, you can do it.
Yes.
And you actually have a loss to give. But it means that you're going to have to put up like a 5-1-1, or I guess 6-1-1 performance, really, to be able to do that. And that, you know, that's what it takes to top eight a Pro Tour qualifier, except your opponents are the best people in the world.
That's right. So, and it's not going to get any easier tomorrow. No. So, another result that we just had come in, John Finkel has defeated Patrick Chapin 2-1. Teammates.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's always a interesting situation because I think that, well, tell me about it.
John was playing the blue deck that they opted into, and Patrick was playing the black-white deck.
Yeah.
So, you know, kind of an interesting triumph of one over the other. Again, those are the two 8-0 decks that we're seeing right now. I mean, but a lot of time, you know, these teams are huge. I mean, it's not like it used to be back in the day where you had five people together and it was a team. That was, like, on the larger end. With these super teams, it makes sense that they would fragment into different decks. Mm-hmm. The different people would gravitate toward working with one another.
That's right.
I mean, and, you know, you want to be communicative.
Huge.
But, yeah, they're just gargantuan. I mean, they're like a significant percentage of the field.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So let's take a quick look here. Jeremy Dizani, 7-1. Lucas Tayak, 7-1 as well. Mm. John Finkel, 7-1. Just, we always see his name up there. You just get so used to it. Makihima Hara, he is 20th in the world currently, and he is 7-1, proving that he has earned that. Sam Black, again, 8-0, and Paul Rietzl, 8-0. There are two undefeateds. All right, why don't we let's talk a little bit about the day as a whole. You know, we had three rounds of draft earlier. Did it? I'm sure you had some expectations coming in here. You were on the design and development team for Theros. You've done some drafts yourself. Did it meet your expectations as far as what you expected to see?
No, it met my expectations in terms of it seems like a very good draft format. The color balance is great. The archetypes that you can draft are fun and interesting and exciting.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that ran counter to my expectations is how fast those limited games were.
I mean, I don't know if we just got like a weird set of circumstances, but we were out of the feature match area so quickly every time. And like, are we going to go to another match? Yeah. No, there is no other match. It was like every single time things were just done.
We watched four matches of Magic in like 32 minutes.
Yeah, it really burned right by.
And still had tons of filler time here at the desk. You know, we had to review a lot of results.
Yeah.
So that kind of blew my mind. I think strategically interesting, but relatively fast format. I think that's largely due, you know, the heroic decks can be blisteringly fast. People figured out how good the base red deck is with cards like Dragon Scales. those decks get off, or sorry, Dragon Mantle. Mm-hmm. Those decks get off to a fast start, and it's just hard to come back from behind.
Yeah, and we saw that for sure. And I know for me, coming in, I expected to see the full gamut.
Yeah.
And I did. And that was something that I wasn't sure. You know, there are times when you come into the Pro Tour and people show you different looks that you hadn't seen. They go hard in one direction that maybe you don't see as much on, like a Magic Online draft or at your local shop. But here, I have to say, you know, after talking to a lot of people, I mean, I talk a lot about Limited. It's you know, something I enjoy doing, and I talk to a lot of different people about Limited. And I noted that this set in particular was one of the most diverse. I mean, it's pretty common that you'll get a lot of different opinions about a limited format. That happens all the time. But this one has been particularly just so spread out on the different opinions that I've gotten.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, and the card valuations, it's impressive to me. I mean, every single pro you talk to seems to have different rankings for almost every color.
Yes.
You know, people are not agreeing. I mean, black is sort of centered around Gray Merchant and Asphodel.
That is the one spike.
Yeah.
You know, that that's good.
But beyond that, I mean, there's tons of disagreement. And the standard environment, I think, is interesting. And that so many people, especially, you know, I was testing a little bit with some of the Americans, had a lot of conversations with the Croatian guys. There's a lot of you know, consensus that, like, okay, we know what the format is. It's going to be these decks. It's going to be this type of thing. And yet, the 2-8-0 decks are decks that came out of essentially nowhere.
Yeah.
We see the French guys on a deck that, you know, sort of mono blue devotion, but with black for Thoughtseize. Mm-hmm. You know, so we're really seeing a lot of innovation here, despite what several people kind of thought of was a relatively stabilized early format.
Yeah, you know, so I was going to ask you, Zach, just as you were coming in, I actually want to stick with what you're saying before you get to that question, though. So, you were just mentioned, like, let's take a look at our 2-8-0 players, right? We have Paul Rietzl sitting in 8-0, and we have Sam Black. Now, they're on the same testing team.
Right.
So it would be like, oh, they must have broke it. They got the sweet deck for the format, right? Well, no. They're actually on two really completely different decks. So how does that happen within a team where, you know, you have two players playing two completely different decks? I mean, these are...
Yeah, I mean, the decks have nothing to do with each other.
Yeah.
And frankly, I don't know the details, so I'm excited we have Paul Rietzl here to tell us exactly kind of how that happened. What usually happens, though, is that, you know, you've got different people. You know, on a given team, some people are limited specialists. Some people are good at refining decks and tweaking them. Some people tend to be deck designers. Mm-hmm. And what happens is, you know, everyone biases toward their own personal results, the feel of the deck they like the most, or the deck that they feel is going to give them personally the best edge based on, you know, what they think the read of the metagame is, et cetera, et cetera.
Sure.
You might have two teams looking at the exact same set of data, but if I think that the most popular deck is going to be mono red and the second most popular deck is going to be green white, and someone else thinks the most popular deck is going to be, you know, Esper Control, and the second most popular deck is going to be Naya, it's going to lead us to playing two different decks. So I'm interested in hearing what Paul says.
Yeah, and that's interesting because the skill is accurately predicting these things, and there is a lot of gap there. It's not like it's a given that you say, well, mono red's going to be a thing. Well, somebody might say, I don't think it is. And somebody's right and somebody's not, you know, or at least more right and more not right. So it looks like we're actually going to be able to bring in two players now. So why don't we bring
players?
In? Yeah, I'm gonna kick you out for a sec, because there's only two seats.
Right,
otherwise,
fine.
I'd kick you.
I'll miss you guys.
Yeah, and we've got our 2 8-0s. Paul, good to see you.
Yes.
Have a seat. Sam Black, good to see you, sir. Hello.
Hey.
So, you guys are the only two undefeated players, at least on our board over there that I know of. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Congrats on 9-0.
Yeah, there you go. Wait a second. You should reverse karma.
Fantastic start. You guys tested together for Team Star City Games, yet you're on completely different decks. Paul, how did that happen?
You know, it's more of a stylistic thing, I think. Mm-hmm. Basically, Patrick said I could play half of a deck that I really wanted to play, and if I just didn't look at the second half of the list, that would be okay. So
you put your hand over it, and you're
this is White Weenie, so it's perfect. And then I just, you know, I play the other cards too.
Okay. And what about for you, Sam? I mean, you've been known, really, really made a name for yourself out here on the Pro Tour scene as an excellent deck builder who has produced serious results recently. What What was your take on this, and how much did you have to do with the build that you ended up playing?
Almost nothing. I mean, we're playing a deck that I, you know, thought of an early version of a long time ago, but I wasn't the one who was pushing for the deck. I wasn't the one who built this version. I mean, my version didn't even have Master of Waves, which is, like, the most important card. Mm-hmm. I think this was mostly Kai.
Nassif.
Yeah. You know, I wasn't, like, really a part of the early testing for it. I was working on some other stuff. But everyone got on board, and I just, like, started watching games, and it was very impressive. And, I mean, you know, when everyone who I respect as much as I do is saying, this is the deck to play, it's awesome, I have to pay attention. And then we started, like, testing the bad matchups, and we were winning about half the time. I only played the deck against matchups that we thought would be pretty bad in testing, and I was winning, like, at least half the games. So
okay. That's a good sign.
I was like, this feels good. Like, uh-huh. And you say there are some other matches that I just get to beat for free. All right, I'm in. But, I mean, even, like, the day before, you know, really, like, at the 11th hour, I was between the deck he's playing and the deck that I'm playing.
Okay.
And it was just like, okay, let me test these bad matchups and see if they're unsolvable or see if we have good plans. If we have good plans, then I'll play this. Otherwise, I'll, like, think about playing that and see if they are comfortable with where they are against everything. And I was just happy enough with where we were in our bad matchups that I decided to stick with this.
All right,
but I think they're both excellent decks.
Okay, yeah, and there's some evidence of that here. So you went 5-0. Was it pretty smooth sailing for you with the deck, or is it one of those decks that kind of can find a win but ekes it out? Like, were you
a little
just
of each.
Smashing
I mean, I played
people?
Some. I mean, I played a bunch of very tight games. The one feature match that I had on camera, I think, the last game was on camera, and I think that was a pretty excellent game. Mm-hmm. Very close. And, like, the last round, I threw away game one. We didn't really need that one. And, I mean, there have been, like, a couple, like, you know, sloppy plays where I just, like, forget to scry or forget to evolve or forget to tap something with a tide binder, like, forgot to tap my opponent's Frostborn Weird. Mm-hmm. Most of my decision-making I've been very happy with, but there have been some...
A few minor slip-ups.
A few little slip-ups, but, like, I'm pretty happy with where I'm at considering how little I actually played the deck. Most of my testing was just, like, watching other people play the deck, okay. Which was very useful and just gave me a sense of, like, yeah, this is a deck I want to be playing. But I didn't have a ton of practice, like, going through the mechanics of playing the deck.
Okay.
And also, I mean, like, when we were testing, there was, like, a time when the team was, like, watching John play and Matt Costa was on Scry Watch. Like, every turn he had to be like, no, Scry.
Like, and then, slapping, like, John's hand every time
then,
he doesn't,
like,
Scry.
John, like, switched to testing the deck that Paul's playing, and one turn he just, like, randomly scries in his upkeep, and they're like, no, John, you don't get to do that anymore.
We all have to watch John to make sure he's playing technically well enough to make sure the testing isn't skewed.
So sure.
That's important.
That's why the team's so big. So
we just put someone on John watch, you know what I mean?
He's got your shift. Yeah, no, I'm on John watch. Now, what about your deck, Paul? How does it normally play out? Would you classify it as an aggressive, a mid-range? What is it trying to do?
Jeez, I have no idea. I guess it's a mid-range deck. I think I got tricked into it because I was told it was a beatdown deck. Uh-huh. I didn't do much of that. Usually I attacked them for about 4, and then I got into this mid-game situation where all their creatures were bigger than mine, and then I had to draw some cards and try to kill those things, and my guys were still sitting there, and then they got to attack them afterwards, basically.
Okay.
And that's how the game kind of worked. It's so weird. I've never played a deck with less synergy that was more powerful and consistent. You know?
Oh, is that right?
It's just, yeah.
A bunch of independently strong
cards.
Yeah,
between you know... you know, between scrying, and I don't want to reveal too much about individual card choices.
But, that's fair.
But the deck puts together a very proactive, disruptive, aggressive game plan, gets on the board first, can answer any threat basically in the format, has excellent mana for like a mid-rangey deck, and can really get out of any situation. I just played against my worst matchup by a mile, you know, which is mono red, had, you know, not a great hand in game 3 and was still able to kind of win. So that's a testament to kind of the individual power level of some of the cards. You know, I've never been one to really play a mid-range deck because I just don't understand why a bunch of good cards together can work, but I'm kind of learning.
So it's like the opposite of our deck, where
exactly.
We're playing a bunch of, like, mediocre cards that work really well together, all synergy. That deck is just, like, a bunch of all-stars.
Yeah, Nassif designed a monocolor aggro deck, and I just thought, I can't do that anymore. That's never worked for me in the past. So,
yeah. So what was it like being on the other side, though? I mean, you have a lot more answers in this deck than you do threats, at least compared to what you're used to playing. Yeah. Does it give you a pretty huge advantage to to understand exactly what the aggressive player is thinking and what he's trying to do?
No, it's exhausting and it's terrifying. I mean, it's awful. I hate being in this position. You know, I mean, my neck and my shoulder hurt. My lower back hurts. You know,
every time we cut to you, you're like this.
Yeah, it's miserable because, like, you know, like, I mean, I know if I were in their shoes, my hand would be perfect. You know, I would have more threats and I would probably, you know, have, you know, more ways to apply pressure. So, you know, you have to kind of balance judiciously using your reactive spells, trying to continue to apply pressure and disrupt. It's it's a very difficult deck to play and use for a deck that's just basically all sorcery speed, do things or whatever, you know?
Right.
And it's very mentally taxing. And playing against aggressive decks, that especially because there's a couple really good ones, the blue deck and mono red, it's not easy. But you know, the good news is again with the deck that we have, because of the high individual power levels of the cards, if you draw them in the right order and like I said, use the very few spells that you have at the right moments, you can deal with even everyone's very best draws, you know, because you can just on curve outclass them. So
that's got to be very comforting, as often that's not the case.
It's a new thing. I'm enjoying it though.
Yeah. Now, Sam, talk to us a little bit about limited coming in. You tend to pile up a lot of drafts before a PT. Was that the case for Theros?
Yeah.
And how comfortable were you coming in?
Very. I'd been doing really well in the drafts at our house. Went, like, 2-1 a vast majority of the time. And, you know, obviously that's with a bunch of players I respect.
The team is pretty stacked.
I felt like I had a very good idea of how to draft, like, all the colors. I've been like pretty flexible in the drafts and stuff. So I felt like I knew the format pretty well, and then I opened Elspeth and that made it pretty easy.
Oh, must be nice. So how happy were you with the deck that you ended up playing today for 3-0? I mean, obviously
it was like a 10 out of 10.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's
I just tweeted
nice.
A picture of it. It's
okay, I'll check
really
that
good.
Out. I follow you on Twitter, as everyone should.
Yeah, I tried to tweet it earlier, but the internet was, there are so many people on it. But now I managed to get it out there, so.
But you were completely confident and happy with it. What about you, Paul? How comfortable were you with the limited format coming in, and how good was your deck today?
Well, one thing that I said, I think I wrote in the past in one of my reports when I actually did well in a tournament a long time ago, was that I found that my tendency to prefer archetypes is inversely related to my comfort with the format. So if I'm like forcing something, or if I have a preference for an archetype, it's usually for formats that I'm not very well prepared for.
Okay.
And it means that I don't necessarily know the card evaluations, or I'm not quite sure how to make, like, say, the blue-red deck work, or I don't really know the pick order for, you know, green-black dredge, or whatever the case may be. And for this tournament, you know, just based upon, you know, really losing all my matches at the house and knowing what didn't work, and then speaking with people who are better than me and whose opinions I respect, I honestly felt like I kind of know how good every card is in Theros and Limited, and there was nothing, no pack or situation that I felt uncomfortable drafting. And so I was able to really get in the zone during the draft and felt like any two-color combination was one that I could take successfully.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Can I throw out a little plug here?
Of course.
So he mentioned talking about it in the house afterward. We actually, a couple nights ago, had a conversation with our whole house in the castle that was recorded. And I believe that'll be posted on our team page later, where we just like go through like all of our thoughts on the draft format. We talk through how much we like all the rares and various color combinations and our favorite commons and stuff like that.
Oh, that's going to be really good stuff for people to listen to. Thanks for sharing that. Okay, guys, I'm going to let you go. You guys have some resting to do, maybe some more testing, whatever, after your successful day one.
Yeah.
And I think I'm going to give you guys actually an update. Oh, actually, we're just going to go straight now. All right, so we've got the end of day wrap now. Rich Hagen, Brian David Marshall at the wall.